Friends, good morning and welcome to worship on this fourth Sunday of Advent. Hello to everyone here in the pews and hello to everyone at home on the Facebook Live. I am glad that you are able to join us in this new way. Do you feel something different? Love is in the air, Pat. Love is in the air. It's because it's the fourth Sunday of Advent. When we focus on God's love for us and the love that we are able to then that overflows from our hearts into others through acts of kindness and in acts of love. And I am continually thankful and grateful that we can gather together, that we can gather together in person and share in God's love by hearing God's word and sharing in the Lord's Supper. It is a blessing that we can be here, and I thank you all for abiding by the protocols we have set forth so that we can continue in this joyous celebration. I'm also thankful, and I know Gretchen is too, for all the hard laughs that you give me every week with my jokes. So I have two more for you today. What do you call a snowman with a six-pack? An abdominal snowman. I am not one of those. Yeah, different six-pack there, Greg, different six-pack. What did the peanut butter say to the grape on Christmas? "'Tis the season to be jelly." Okay, that wasn't as bad, I guess. Okay. Friends, I am so grateful that you are here. I'm grateful for all those who are leading a song today that we can rejoice in God's love for us. So now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prelude.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Friends, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray the prayer of the day found in your bulletin together. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. With your abundant grace and might, free us from the sin that would obstruct your mercy, that willingly we may bear your redeeming love to all the world. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the lighting of the Advent wreath. Speaking the fourth stanza together, that's found in your bulletin. Light four candles to watch for Messiah. Let the light banish the darkness. He is coming. Tell the glad tidings. Let your light be shining. Now let us turn our hearts to hear God's word.
To God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but it is now disclosed, and through prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and all of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing is impossible with God." And then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Mike has graciously allowed me to use his stand for today, so thank you. Friends, grace to you and peace from God the Father, through the crucified and risen Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What happens when you hear good news? What do you think about? How do you react? I think incredibly good news doesn't hit our ears all that often. Instead, I think the world beats us down with expectation, telling us we must act a certain way, think certain things, and live according to particular standards. The American dream is this goal that overshadows everything we do. We aspire to have the perfect family, the white picket fence, the nice sedan and van, and the beautiful home with the manicured lawn. Now, I want to be clear. I don't think there's anything wrong with setting goals and aspiring to do better in life. I also don't think there's anything wrong with wanting something more simple. If you turn on the HGTV channel, you can see programs that reference the biggest mansions in the world, but also Tiny Home Nation, where they live on literally like 100 square feet. I don't know how they do it, but it's a personal decision they make. It's a personal decision anybody makes. The scripture we heard from the Gospel of Luke is commonly known as the Annunciation. It's an amazing, unique story filled with promise, confusion, hope, love, and ultimately good news. Although you would think seeing an angel would be slightly terrifying, Mary doesn't seem too fazed by it. Rather, it's the angel Gabriel's words, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." These words that come from the angel's mouth perplex Mary. One commentator puts it this way: what kind of greeting indeed? Was he kidding? Was Gabriel mocking her? Was the angel setting her up? We don't know all the reasons she may have been perplexed, but the moment you stop to think about you realize the possibilities are endless. From her circumstances of being in a socioeconomic level relatively low, from her gender and age, to her life experience thus far, there are so many reasons to doubt the sincerity of the angel's greeting, and perhaps not to understand it at all. And perhaps the one possibility that doesn't even occur to Mary until Gabriel continues is that he's serious about what he says. She is favored by God, and God is with her. So I ask again, what happens when you hear good news? Are you perplexed? Do you question it? Do you feel worthy of it? I invite you to think back to when you found out you and your spouse were going to have a child. What were your reactions? How about the mothers who have suffered miscarriages to finally hear the doctor say the baby is healthy, and then the baby is laid on the mother's breast? Think about the students like this past week who heard there is a 2-hour delay or a snow day. They can't believe it, so they check the site multiple times just to make sure. And I'm sure there are other times in your life where you've heard and experienced good news. But right now, let's use Mary. Imagine seeing what she saw and hearing what she heard. She was living in a remote village far from the busy religious center of Jerusalem. She had no hint that she was destined for a singularly distinctive role in history. She was keeping her head low and doing her work. She was engaged, ready to be a partner to her soon-to-be husband, Joseph. And I also think it's not too far to say that she probably had some self-doubt. She probably was anxious about something. And she probably felt unworthy somehow, some way, like most of us do. And here appears Gabriel, out of nowhere, in the midst of it all, proclaiming, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." A perplexed Mary is not surprising, especially since this good news can be hard to believe when you don't feel worthy and when it comes out of nowhere. But isn't that what God does? God comes out of nowhere and changes our lives. God comes out of nowhere proclaiming good news. God comes to us, sinful, imperfect people. It doesn't make sense. But I don't think God's been in the business of status quo or making sense most of the time. God is constantly changing expectations. God is flipping the world around to make it right side up. And God does this by coming down to earth in the form of a baby boy to an engaged couple who are vulnerable to the social pressures of the time. What I think is even more amazing about the Annunciation is the way the story ends. Mary goes from this perplexed person to truly trusting the good news that she is favored. And it results with these words, "Here am I." Here am I. Mary's words represent what faith is all about, love and trust. Mary's story moves us all from what we think we are to what God has called us to be. From observant believer to confessing apostle. And one commentator says, "Moreover, and remarkably, and maybe even impossibly, Mary's story demands that we acknowledge the very transformation of God. It is no small journey to go from our comfortable perceptions of God to God in the manger, vulnerable, helpless, dependent. And yes, this is the promise of Christmas. This story is the gospel Paul talks about when he says, my gospel. The gospel comes from God and moves through hearts by the Spirit's power. The gospel is about a loving God who comes down to earth to walk among us, to experience everything that we go through. It's not the gospel of American ideals. It's not the gospel of individuality. It's not the gospel of me, myself, and I. It's not the gospel of a political party. Good news is good news for everyone, especially the most vulnerable in our communities. And the fact God enters our vulnerabilities, our helplessness, and our dependencies, I think we're in good company with Mary. When God proclaims good news and we are perplexed, we are in good company with Mary. When we begin to trust in God's word, we are in good company with Mary. As recipients of God's favor in the waters of baptism, and in the bread and wine, and in God's word, please hear this good news. You are loved, and you are enough. No matter what the world says you should be, no matter what the world expects of you, no matter what you think you should be, you are loved by God, by the God who created you. You are enough in God's eyes because God has chosen for you salvation in Jesus Christ. God has chosen for you forgiveness in Jesus Christ. And God has chosen to redeem you in Jesus Christ. God loves you. You don't want to even know even better news? You can't escape it. God will continue to seek you out, find you in your vulnerabilities, and call you to service to share his love with your neighbors. Friends, in these last few days of Advent, I want you to rest. I want you to rest in the comfort that you are loved and you are enough. And when you can't quite feel or hear that good news, know you are in good company with Mary. Know that you have a community here that will hold on to Christ's love for you and continue to share it with you. So lean. Lean on us. Lean on me. But most importantly, lean on the God who shows up in the manger. Lean on the God who sends the angel Gabriel proclaiming these words, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." Amen. Friends, let us confess the faith of the church with the words of the Apostles' Creed, which are printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God of power and might, fulfill your promise and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. Let us respond to each petition with, "Your mercy is great." Gracious God, all generations call you blessed. In this holy season, we pray for our neighbors of other denominations and faiths. Inspire the faith of their people. Cultivate understanding amongst us and strengthen us in love and service to our community. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Creator God, you scatter the proud. Everything we have belongs first to you. Bless and protect the seas, mountains, plains, forests, skies, and soils that surround us. Give us humility as we tend them. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Righteous God, you humble the powerful and lift up the lowly. We pray for all leaders of all nations that they amplify the voices of people in need. Guide all people entrusted with your leadership to create societies in which everyone can flourish. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Healing God, you pour out mercy to all who cry out to you. Surround everyone in need of healing in body, mind, or spirit with your tender presence. And we pray especially today for Rosemary Cameron, Mark, Susan Hassan, Yvonne Lorenz, Patty Ryan, Kathy and Rick Henderson, Claire McCluskey, Michelle Logan, Allison McMay and Helen, Connie Seth and Ian Hudson, Kathy and John Harvey, for Daniel, Robert McKnight, Debbie Ross, Drew, Bernadette McDaniel, the family of Marge Gildy, Leo Decker, Joyce Nevin, Kelsey Cox, Glenn Byerling, the family of Barney Ziervogel, the family of Betty Luna, and the family of Marianne Hartman. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Compassionate God, you fill the hungry with good things and call the rich to give generously. Nourish those who lack access to adequate food and nutrition. Bless the work of advocates, community organizers, and food pantries. Encourage others to provide for their neighbors in need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Eternal God, you are faithful to the promises you made to our forebears. We give thanks for the ministry of those who organized, planned, dreamed, encouraged, and reached out as they served you. We give thanks for the bold leadership of female leaders in our own time. Inspire others with their steadfast witness. And we pray for all those who aren't able to join us in this season because they now rest in you. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you always. Look around, share a sign of peace with your neighbor. The generosity of this congregation, again, continues to put me in awe, for which I am so thankful, because we can continue to do God's work in this world. With your help, with your person, we are able to extend the church from beyond these doors. We are also able to help people by feeding them as they come to church, to the building on Thursdays for Nicanor, and we continue all these good things to steward ourselves, our time, and our possessions well, and in the name of God's love. Today I would like for us, if you came in, I hope you all got an ornament or two. I'm going to invite the praise team up as I give out instructions. While the praise team plays, I invite you to come forward and place an ornament or two on the tree up here. As you do, I want you to think of all the ways God's hope, peace, joy, and love has been with you at this time, has been shared with you, and how you've shared it with others. If you need help putting it up, Aria's up here. We'll make sure to decorate it and make sure it's all even. So let this be a time of reflection and offering, that we are offering ourselves to God and offering all the joys that we have in our lives. Friends, again, thank you so much for your generosity. Thank you. Friends, thank you so much for participating in that offering. Aria had said something earlier that it reminds her of when we nail our sorrows to the cross in Lent. So when we are able to place the chrismons on the tree, we are reminded that Christ is the King, that Christ is our Savior, that Christ is the peace that comes in this world, and that is the joy that we get from God and as we share in God's love. So friends, let us pray. God of abundance, we bring before you the precious fruits of your creation, and with them our very lives. Teach us patience and hope as we care for all those in need until the coming of your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Friends, I invite you to stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. And blessed are you for your Son, Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks. He broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we proclaim the mystery of faith. And we remember your word dwelling among us full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in Jesus' death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us, bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and daily teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you. The Lord is with you in the bread and wine. The Lord's very own body and blood, given for you this day to remind you always that you are loved and that you are enough, and no one can take that away from you. Friends, come taste and see that the Lord is indeed good. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Friends, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God, for whom we wait, in this meal you give us a foretaste of that day when the hungry will be fed with good things. Send us forth to make known your deeds and to proclaim the greatness of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I have a few announcements for us before we head out today. We are continuing to collect for all of our social ministries for the ELCA Good Gifts, which you can place in the teal box back there. Hats, mittens, and socks for the Help Center in Elkton, and always food for the St. Mary Ann's Food Pantry. We also want to send the Christmas cards that we made last week to Calvert Manor in Rising Sun. They have 110 residents, and we've made 40 cards. So if possible, you made 20 more. Okay, so we've made 60. So we still need 50, and we have 8 back there. So if everyone, before you leave, could just go to Celebration Hall, make one or two real quick so that we can take them up to the Calvert Manor to share this time of joy and love to our neighbors. We'll be there for about a half hour after service. We continue to do Advent Zoom midweek worship. We will have our last one this Wednesday at 7 p.m. I think we've been doing, we've had some great discussions. Worship has been centering refreshing restful time to be in prayer, to hear God's word, and to meditate on it. It's very simple. You just click on the link that's provided weekly and on Facebook if you wish to join. As Gretchen reminded me, there's no commute time for this service, so you don't even have to worry about anything. Exactly. You can wear anything you want. Alrighty. So now the fun part. You all know I love you, right? And I only want the safest and best things for us and for us to worship. So Christmas Eve is obviously this Thursday. We'll be worshiping the Nativity of our Lord. But after much, much, much prayerful thought, we are still having in-person service, but what is going to happen is that there will not be a barn service per se. Rather, we will be having an outdoor parking lot service here at the church at 3:30, which allows us, for those of you and those outside of our community who may not get this message, to be able to come to the church. If they were to go up to the barn at 3 o'clock, we'll have someone stationed there to then journey down this way. And if we get 10 people, great. If we get 50, great. But with the rain, it just doesn't seem right to cram us all into a small space and then not be able to sing. If we're out here in the parking lot, we'll be able to spread out more. We'll have our umbrellas. There won't be mud everywhere. So that's what we're going to change up. We're also going to add a 7 o'clock service on Thursday. It's going to be a traditional service. It's going to be identical to what would happen at 9. But what I want from us is at the end of the service, there's 2 sign-up sheets in the back, and just for you to indicate which service you want to attend, either at 7 o'clock or 9 o'clock. We want to cap these services at 25, 30 people, so then we can ensure if we have any visitors, that they will be welcome here, because my biggest fear is that nobody would go to the barn service, everybody would come here at 9 o'clock, and we wouldn't have places to put people. And we would either have to say, go into Celebration Hall, or they would have to leave. And I don't want to do that. So what we're going to do is we're going to do 2 services. Obviously, not everyone is here. I will be sending out a message today for people to sign up. But since you are here, you get first come, first serve. Again, the cap is going to be 25. We can adjust that depending on family units, but with the governor's orders, with what Cecil County recommends, I think this is the best way that we can continue to celebrate our Lord's birth as safely as possible, and I think we'll be able to lightly sing if we're actually able to space out and not have 50 people in here, but actually have 25 or 30. We'll be able to be a little bit more generous with space, and we'll be able to enjoy the hymns potentially a little bit more. So that's my announcement. It's been changing all over the place. I think this is the safest way we can do it, and I keep reminding myself that I'm just grateful that we can do something in person and it's not virtual. So we will still be gathering here. Please sign up after worship on the sign-up sheets in the back right by the ELCA Good Gifts offering for what service you plan to attend. Just write your household name and then how many people, and we'll just keep monitoring that from there. Are there any questions about the sign-up process? Are there any announcements for the good of the order? That's right. One person has told me that they found all three wise men. Now the question is, have you? The wise men are journeying up. If you've noticed, they are not where they were last week. They magically walked up, keep walking up to the nativity scene. So I invite you, if you have a little bit of time and you want to do a little scavenger hunt, to find them. And maybe you can ask one of the Polino kids over there. They might be able to help you. But with that, please rise for the benediction. Friends, be people of love. Let love live in your heart and share the love of Christ with all you meet. Share love by loving those you see regularly. Start by loving your community. Share love by loving those you do not know. How do your actions affect the rest of God's creation? Share love by praying for our world. In this Advent season, we need to see, feel, and share love all the time. So as you go into the wonder of God's creation, share love, share joy, share peace, and share hope with all those you meet. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us go in love to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.